what I'd like to acknowledge is that Southern Response understands that this is a really difficult situation for the Dodds. We've met with the Dodds this morning. We've apologised for the situation we're in, and we've explained to them why we are appealing. And the reason we're appealing is so that Southern Response has greater clarity on the law, so that we understand what we need to do moving forward, and so that we can do the right thing.
Did your shareholder drive the appeal, though? The government wanted you to appeal, didn't they?
The decision was not taken lightly, and the decision was made by the Crown. It was ultimately made by the Attorney General, but it was in consultation with Southern Response, with Crown Law, with the Treasury, and external legal advisers.
Left to your own devices, would you have appealed?
Look, I think our advice is we do need to appeal, and the reason we need to appeal is to get that clarity so that other people in the Dodds situation don't have to go through a court process like the Dodds have gone through, because we understand that's not a situation we want to put anyone in.
But aren't you putting them in it again by appealing? Aren't you? I mean, if you didn't want to put people in it, you would settle now, wouldn't you?
Yep, so, and that's what we explained to Mr. and Mrs. Dodds, is that we are having to put Mr. and Mrs. Dodds in the situation. It is regretful, and we do understand the turmoil that it puts them through. But what it does do is allow us to look at other customers who potentially could be in the situation, avoid them having to go to court, avoid years and years of legal issues by getting this resolved as quickly as we possibly can.
I don't understand why you have to go to the appeal court to do that.
Yep.
First of all, you have a class action waiting.
Yep.
So you could actually pursue the class action, couldn't you, or allow the class action to be pursued.
Yep.
So I don't understand why you've got to go to the appeal court to establish the rights and wrongs of this case. It's been established in the appeal court, it's been established in the Supreme Court in Avonside, it's been established in the High Court in Dodds.
Yep. So it isn't quite as simple as that. So the thing which we're seeking clarity on is there a legal obligation for Southern Response to take the judgments made today, to take the legal precedent set today and apply that back in time, reopen a settlement which was made when the law was one thing? Do we need to take today's law and apply it backwards to that settlement and pay that customer additional amounts when the law wasn't that amount?
We're not talking about the law though, are we, Anthony? We're talking about the interpretation of the law.
Yep.
I mean, nothing's changed in law, we're just talking about how it was interpreted. And if we go back to the Supreme Court in 2015, and so in Avonside, you won in the High Court, it was appealed, you lost in the Appeal Court, and you lost Southern Response, not you. Southern Response lost in the Appeal Court and lost in the Supreme Court. And you said at the time, when people were saying, why the hell are you going all the way to the Supreme Court? You said in 2015, given the doubt arising from the respective rulings between the High Court and the Court of Appeal in this case, we considered it important to have the law clarified by the Supreme Court and are pleased that this has now taken place. In other words, the law was clarified 4 years ago. You knew where you stood 4 years ago.
Yep, and I think if you look at the response that Southern Response made to when that was clarified, is we went back to the point at which that law was clarified and we said, yep, we understand that and we will pay the amounts that are owing once we know that law has been clarified, and we've been doing that since that time. The question that we are here, and this is exactly the point you're making, is we haven't got clarity. Are we required to go back in time and keep applying that law back in time? And that's what we're seeking. And the other thing which is really important is we're trying to understand who that would apply to and the principles in which it would apply if we do go back in time.
Wouldn't the class action tell you this?
Absolutely. So the class action is another vehicle that could tell us that. The difficulty with the class action is it's years away. It's going to go through a process. This is the opportunity. Now, this is the opportunity in the appeal court to fast track a process and get that clarity a lot earlier.
I just don't understand what clarity you would get that you don't already have.
Yep.
So you have the appeal court and the Supreme Court in Avonside. You have Justice Gendel's extraordinary judgment in the Dodds case, which came out in August. I don't understand what greater clarity you need. This reeks of the shareholder not wanting to pay out an estimated $300 million. That's not you, it's the shareholder, but you are fronting this. It reeks of the government not wanting to write the checks.
So, look, I can be really clear. The previous government and this government have tasked Southern Response to pay out the entitlement of our customers. That is absolutely crystal clear for us, and it is our core purpose. What this is trying to understand is how we do that. Do we need to go back in time and do that? The judgment in the Dodds was around the Fair Trading Act and our behaviour under the Fair Trading Act, and it is slightly different, and that's why we're seeking clarity.
What did the Crown want from you? I looked at, and you weren't here at the time, but I looked at Gerry Brownlee's letter of expectation to Southern Response and its chair for the 2014-15 year, and he said, and I quote, "Returning to surplus in 2014-15 is a key priority for the government, and any variation from the currently expected performance of wholly owned subsidiaries of the Crown, i.e. Southern Response, will have an impact on the Crown's accounts." You were explicitly being told by the government to lowball so they could pay a surplus, weren't you?
I can say that's a categorically no, that we have never been told to lowball offers. We've been instructed to ensure that our customers get the entitlements that they have under their AMI policy. And I think the important thing to really remember is that AMI was a private company. It was going to fail. The government stepped in, established Southern Response, so that those claimants, those Cantabrians, could get their entitlements under the insurance policy. Now, to date, we've settled 48,000 claims. Potentially, those claims wouldn't have been settled if this government hadn't stepped in and done something about it. And I know we've made mistakes. I understand that this has been really hard for people, but this government has been supportive of what Southern Response is trying to do, and it has been very clear that they are committed to settling the remaining customers.
So when I see a Treasury report, a briefing to the incoming minister, Grant Robertson, from July, talking about the significant fiscal risks for the Crown, and talking about once a decision is released on the Dodds, so this was before the Dodds, Justice Kendall's Dodds announcement, Treasury will engage with Crown Law and Southern Response to provide advice on recommended next steps in relation to these matters. In other words, Treasury's driving this, aren't they?
Treasury aren't driving this. I mean, I met with Minister Robertson and Minister Woods this morning. They are very clear. Southern Response will do the right thing, and we will pay the entitlements to our customers that the court will set out the principles for which we need to pay.
I'm sorry to be stubborn and keep returning to the point, but the court set out the principles. It set it out in Avonside in the appeal court. It set it out in Avonside in the Supreme Court. It set it out in Dodds in the High Court in August. How many more principles do you need from the court? At what stage are you going to start listening to the court?
What I said before is the principle we're really trying to understand is, does Southern Response have a legal obligation to go back in time, reopen a settlement which was based on the law at that time, and pay additional funds?
It wasn't based on the law at the time, it was based on your interpretation of the law at that time.
Absolutely, and that's what you have in this. And I mean, unfortunately, it is an insurance contract, and you have to interpret that contract with the law at the time.
You're not going to enjoy this, but I'm going to read you some of Justice Kendall. So he says, Southern Response has misrepresented the position by disclosing or relying upon a document which was false and misleading. False and misleading. He says, I find that these representations repeated on many occasions here were false and misleading. Editing or redacting parts of such an important assessment document, that's the DRA, and then suggesting it is the complete and only assessment of total rebuild cost as occurred here is misleading and deceptive. Now, those kind of judgments litter Justice Kendall's judgment on Southern Response. What is the appeal court going to say at variance to that? What are you after from them? What do you possibly think you can win there?
So I think it's important to say that what Justice Kendall was really careful to point out was this was not fraudulent behaviour. And what Southern Response honestly believed at the time was that we were providing the costs to the Dodds that they were entitled to under the policy option of buy another house. As an example, under buy another house, Southern Response believed at the time that the law said you didn't pay a customer for designing a brand new house for the architect's fees for designing that house, so they didn't pay them for those amounts because they didn't believe they were entitled to them under that buy another house policy option. So I understand your perspective,
But I'm just quoting Justice Kendall. And Justice Kendall says, the issue is not the accuracy of the figures in the DRA. It is that some figures were deliberately omitted in a way that rendered the document and its meaning false. Now, the Supreme Court and the Appeal Court told us something pretty similar in the Avonside case. At what stage are you or your shareholder going to go, mea culpa, actually, we were running a two-tier DRA system and we've got to pay up?
So it's never been a secret that we have internal costings, and most insurance companies have an internal costing document which may have costs such as the internal administration cost, claims handling costs, and it also has a range of insurance entitlement costs in there. In this situation, we had a customer who asked what we believed I asked for, what is my entitlement under buy another house? And Southern Response at that time gave the honest opinion of, here are the costs you're entitled to under buy another house.
Was it the honest opinion? Was it, why does Justice Kendall keep saying, you know, I've just turned to points 95 and 96, false and misleading used twice in consecutive paragraphs.
Yeah. So I think it's important to note that false and misleading is a tenet under the Fair Trading Act. It isn't a moral judgment in itself. And Justice Gainer was really careful to say that he didn't see evidence of fraudulent behaviour. And as I said before, Southern Response had the honest opinion that those were the costs that customer was entitled to.
I'm sorry to push you on this. How could you possibly have retained that as an honest opinion after Avonside, after the Appeal Court and the Supreme Court? Wasn't it just a matter of convenience to retain that as an honest opinion?
So I think you're confusing a couple of things. As I was saying, at that time when that claim was settled, Southern Response had the honest opinion, the interpretation of the law, that those costs were what the customer was entitled to at that time. And the judgments came later, and we changed our practices when the interpretation of the law changed.
Okay, you did, and you absolutely did. So after the Supreme Court, from October 2014, going forward, you haven't done what you have found by Justice Kendall to have done in the Dodds case, right? So why didn't you go back retrospectively and say, holy moly, we've been found wanting by the Appeal Court, we've been found wanting by the Supreme Court. Going forward, we're going to make the higher payment. Let's go back and put it right. Why didn't you do that then?
So the purpose of this appeal is to look at, does Southern Response have a legal obligation to go back in time? That's what we're clarifying. But more importantly, what we're trying to clarify is, how do we do that? How many people could this possibly apply to?
Why do you need to appeal, Anthony, to do that? Why can't Treasury work that out for you?
Well, there's a couple of parts to this, and that's, this potentially is going to be a significant amount of money.
How much are we talking about, ballpark? Grant Cameron says $300 million potentially. Do you want to disabuse me of that notion? Is it possible that it will be that much?
It is possible that it could be that much, but what I can't speculate is if that's likely or not. I honestly don't know. And I don't know because we haven't got the clarity from the courts to work out how many people this may apply to and how it applies. And that's what we're seeking from this appeal.
You don't need to appeal to get that clarity, do you? You have your own client base. You have people sitting out there who know who's being paid what and who know how the DRAs were applied. I don't want to give you a hard time because I absolutely believe this was driven by your shareholder, but it's really disingenuous to suggest you need the court to determine this. You can determine it without going back to court, can't you?
So I don't, from what I've seen, I believe that we do need to go to the courts to clarify the principles of going back in time and reopening a settlement that was based on the interpretation of the law at the time. I think there is necessary to get that clarity of, one, do we have to go back? And if we do, how we go back? And we need to do that so that we ensure that when we do go back, if we have to, that we do it right, that it's fair, and then we get enduring settlements for our customers.